إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وضرب الله مثلا قرية كانت آمنة مطمئنة يأتيها رزقها رغدا من كل مكان فكفرت بأنعم الله فأذاقها الله لباس الجوع والخوف بما كانوا يصنعون وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم من فاتته صلاة فكأنما وتر أهله وماله أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام Honorable Ulama Ikram, respected brothers and elders, Allah Rabbul Izzat has repeatedly emphasized in the Quran through various verses His absolute authority and sovereignty to snatch the bounties and the privileges He has favored individuals and nations with. It remains the absolute control and the prerogative of Allah. However, coupled with that, Allah has also mentioned that whenever He has stripped an individual of his previous privileges and advantages, He has done so with reason and wisdom. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَمْ يَكُ مُغَيِّرًا نِعْمَةً أَنْعَمَهَا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ Never did Allah change prosperity to adversity and health to sickness until that individual did not forsake or abandon Allah. On the last page of the 20th juz in Surah An-Kabut, Allah explains it much more in detail. فَكُلًّا أَخَذْنَا بِذَنْبِهِ Every individual we took him to task because of his crimes. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ أَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِ حَاصِبًا There were those who we destroyed with violent winds. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ أَخَذَتْهُ الصَّيْحَةِ There were those who were seized by the awful cry of an angel. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ خَسَفْنَا There were those that we caused the earth to split and swallow them. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ أَغْرَقْنَا There were those that we drowned them in the ocean. Allah then concludes this verse by saying, before you arrive at the conclusion that this is such a cruel Allah, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيَظْلِمَهُمْ وَلَكِنْ كَانُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ In the above manners in which Allah destroyed them, no injustice can be attributed to Allah. Rather, it was them who had wronged themselves and earned the azab of Allah through the actions and the sins they had perpetrated. If you look at the du'as that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had made often and common, one of the du'as that featured in his life daily was, Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min zawali ni'matik wa tahawuli 'afiyatik. O Allah, I ask thy divine protection that I must never be deprived of the privileges you have given me, O Allah. And let not your mercy and your blessings be averted and diverted from me. Wa fuja'ati niqmatik. And O Allah, let me never become a victim of your displeasure. A true believer is one who constantly fears, whoever fears that at any time I can be deprived of the bounties and the privileges that Allah has afforded me. With the grace of Allah, last week I had the opportunity to go to Indonesia and in particular to Bandar Aceh, the prime area which was struck with the tsunami. And I thought briefly I share with you my humble experiences so that it serves as an eye-opener to myself and as well to one and all that have gathered here. But before I narrate to you my brief experiences in my short stay, let us look into Quran and Hadith and objectively analyze without becoming judgmental on the Indonesians or any other nation for that matter. Let us look at those reasons as a result of which nations are deprived of the privileges that Allah has given them. And likewise those good actions that if carried out, then Allah Ta'ala will secure the privileges given and likewise Allah will multiply it. Mughira ibn Shu'bah radiallahu anhu narrates, he himself used to say, Ushkur man an'ama alayk. Be grateful to the one who has favored you. فَإِنَّهُ لَا بَقَاءَ لِلنِّعَمِ إِذَا كَفَرْتَ وَلَا زَوَالَ لَهَا إِذَا شَكَرْتَ Because rest assured, no bounty will ever remain with you if you are ungrateful. And no bounty will ever be snatched from you if you are grateful. What did Mughira ibn Shu'bah radiallahu anhu say? فَإِنَّهُ لَا بَقَاءَ لِلنِّعَمِ إِذَا كَفَرْتَ As long as you are ungrateful, nothing will remain. Allah will take everything. I will tell you and then you can think. We met with brothers who were first one hand tsunami victims, who showed us where their homes existed, who showed us the dwellings, and with tears in his eyes, he said, this is the house where I lived with my parents. This very water, and I can tell it to you, and it was an emotional, and he just broke down into tears. So we will never become judgmental. We will never become judgmental. We make dua for the Muslims wherever they are. What I'm saying is, what are our lessons? What do we deduce? And we should also think that we are in a comfort zone. Remember, if nothing has happened to us, not because we don't deserve it, but because of the sheer mercy of Allah. Otherwise, our actions justify more than anyone else. I can look into my heart, you can look into your heart. وَلَا فَإِنَّهُ لَا بَقَاءَ لِلنِّعَمِ There is no ni'mat will remain with ungratefulness, and no ni'mat will be snatched when there is gratitude. One person came begging to Nabi alayhi salam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him a date. He dropped the date and he said, Tamaratun, one lousy date. What am I going to do with it? Nabi alayhi salam picked up the date. Another person came begging. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam gave that very date to the second beggar. He took it with a spirit and with passion. And he said, you know, this got sentimental value. Tamaratun min Rasulillah. A date from Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Nabi alayhi salam told Umm Salma, you know, you have that 40 dirhams. Give it to this beggar. He's grateful. Give it to this beggar. You know, in English they say, very beautifully said, do not destroy what you have by desiring what you don't. Do not destroy what you have by desiring what you don't. And remember, what you have today was once upon a time amongst the things you ever hoped for. The day Allah gives me a son, the day Allah made you a grandfather now, never mind a son, the day Allah gives me a car, Allah gave you and your wife, the day I own my house, now you own one private and one at a resort also and one at some scenic view. The day, remember, what you have was once upon a time what you desired. Brothers, one deal of ours goes back, and then, you know, we feel our whole castle of hopes are shattered. Something to admire these people there in Indonesia, how they've embraced life. We went right into the rural area. And we tried to take some interviews. Of course, language was difficult to communicate. But how they've embraced life, and they are living with reality in the minimum provisions that they have. Allah Ta'ala speaks in the Quran about those actions through which we can secure the privileges He has given us. And likewise, Allah speaks of those who disobeyed Allah, and as a result of their ingratitude, Allah snatched whatever Allah had favored them. Allah speaks about two brothers in Bani Israel. One who enjoyed a vast kingdom and dominion, the other one was a simple, poor person, a pauper. So one day the poor brother went to visit his rich brother. So again, the wealthy brother with great arrogance. You know, when you stand around and you look at these houses, and people have pitched up tents where their homes were, and children are standing in that very water which claimed the lives of their parents, with a little twine, why my child goes fishing as a hobby, your children at the age of 8 in that very water, and with tears they tell you their mother died here, their father died here, the house was destroyed here, and you look at them and you don't know what to say, and the child drops that twine, and we sat there, you know, when we came, there was a capsized ship right at the water, so I told the brothers, let me just sit here for a little while. And I reflected, and you look at the calm waters, and around it is just devastation, absolute devastation. And yet you see those masjids that have been preserved and have survived the attack. So we need to realize that what we have is Allah's mercy. Allah can seize and snatch at any time. So this brother takes his brother into the garden with great arrogance. So what does the Muslim brother say? وَلَوْلَا إِذْ دَخَلْتَ جَنَّتَكَ قُلْتَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ Listen, my brother, you could show me your garden without arrogance. I would still be impressed. Why are you being so arrogant? Why don't you thank Allah that He gave it to you? Muhammad ibn Ali rahmatullah alayhi used to say, مَا أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ عَبْدٍ بِنِعْمَةٍ Whenever Allah favors an individual with any bounty, and he realizes that I enjoy what I enjoy because of the favor of Allah, إِلَّا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُ شُكْرَهَا قَبْلَ أَن يَشْكُرْ Allah records that as gratitude on his part before he verbally exercises or expresses his gratitude to Allah. That Allah has given me this year, and that is why I enjoy it. So this is the dua that is to be recited. مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ It comes in the hadith Whenever a person sees his house, his car, his children, anything that Allah has given him which he enjoys and brings joy to the heart, then he should recite this dua, very simple dua. By virtue of that, Allah will protect that person, that house, that car against divine tragedies and calamities. So let us make this a common practice that we recite this inshallah. Furthermore, Allah speaks about the nation of Saba. لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَئٍ فِي مَسْكَنِهِمْ آيَةٍ. In some particular areas we went to in Bandar Aceh, which was really very wealthy places, because the certain houses that survived the attack are still double-story massive mansions. And that gives you a glimpse of the nature of the houses in the surrounding area. That it were not small shacks or little huts, they were massive homes, double stories. But again, like I say, you admire one particular house. I can actually, it's vivid before me. The roof had fallen, half the building had collapsed, the windows had shattered, but that family still were living in the remains of that dilapidated house. There was absolutely nothing more they could do. There's no opportunities, there's no economic growth there. As it is, they suffer an economical crisis. Child labor is common. Can you imagine what this has pushed them into? So Allah speaks about the nation of Saba. لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَئٍ فِي مَسْكَنِهِمْ آيَةٍ جَنَّتَانِ عَنْ يَمِينٍ وَشِمَالٍ. Brothers, look at what we enjoy and think about this here. Allah says, indeed in the dwellings of Saba, there was a garden on the right, there was a garden on the left. بَلْدَةٌ طَيِّبَةٌ وَرَبٌّ غَفُورٌ. A wonderful city and a forgiving Allah. A wonderful city and a forgiving Allah. Allah says, I gave them everything. فَأَعْرَضُوا فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِيمِ. But then they showed me their arrogance, their pride, their haughtiness. And overnight I reduced everything to ruins. ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا. Allah says, thus did we recompense them because of their ungratefulness. وَهَلْ نُجَازِ إِلَّا الْكَفُورِ. And if we deprive anyone, it's the ungrateful one. If we deprive anyone, it's the ungrateful one. وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا قَرْيَةً كَانَتْ آمِنًا. Allah speaks about the people of Makkah. Amina, they were living in peace. Mutmainna, they feared nothing. They feared nothing. That brother who was our driver in Bandar Aceh, he was actually a tsunami victim. He says, I was there in the morning. We were outside. It was a Sunday morning. We went to the waters. And I literally seen the waters and I seen the earthquake. Don't ask me how Allah saved me. I ran from there and I went into the masjid and I performed namaz. But with my own naked eyes, I seen people drowning and how buildings collapsed. Allah says they enjoyed all privileges. يَأْتِيهَا رِزْقُهَا رَغَدًا مِّن كُلِّ مَكَانٍ. Wealth, affluence. فَكَفَرَتْ بِأَنْعُمِ اللَّهِ. They chose to be ungrateful to Allah's bounties. فَأَذَاقَهَا اللَّهُ لِبَاسَ الْجُوعِ وَالْخَوْفِ. Allah says then we turn their poverty, their prosperity into poverty, their comfort into fear. And likewise Allah says what happened to this nation? They were ungrateful. They were ungrateful to the ni'mat that the Nabi of Allah was amongst them. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ بَدَّلُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ كُفْرًا وَأَحَلُّوا قَوْمَهُمْ دَارَ الْبَوَارِ. So we have to see how we become grateful to what Allah has given us. How do we become grateful? The Quran says, كُلُوا مِن طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ وَلَا تَتْغَوْ فِيهِ فَيَحِلَّ عَلَيْكُمْ غَضَبِي. Eat from the wholesome provision that Allah has given you and don't transgress therein. Scholars explain what is meant by transgressing, to eat the wholesome provision and then to channel that ability in Allah's disobedience. To channel your resources in Allah's disobedience. So you come home, you have a good meal, you have a wonderful sleep, and after you are fresh and healthy, you go and commit zina, or you go to a casino and you gamble, or you commit any other crime. To channel the abilities that Allah has given you against Allah, Allah says, I will seize what I have given you. Let me tell you an incident that comes in Muslim Sharif, and then I will tell you my experiences. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks about this hadith. It appears in Muslim Sharif, second volume. Inna thalathatan fi bani Israel. Very opportune to tie it up with our discussion. There were three people in bani Israel. Perhaps we heard the incident. Aqra wa abras wa a'ma. But listen to this very closely. One was a leper. He suffered leprosy. One was blind and one was bald. He had no hair. فَأَرَادَ اللَّهُ أَن يَبْتَلِيَهُمْ. Allah decided to test them. فَبَعَثَ إِلَيْهِمْ مَلَكًا. Allah sent an angel to the person suffering leprosy. Came to him. أَيُّ شَيْءٍ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْكَ. What do you love the most? لَوْنٌ حَسَنٌ وَجِلْدٌ حَسَنٌ. That Allah can give me a beautiful appearance with wonderful skin. وَيَذْهَبُ عَنِّي الَّذِي قَدْ قَذَرَنِيَ النَّاسِ. And Allah can cure me against this illness for which society has shunned me. The angel took his hand and gently passed it over this person. Gently passed it. Allah cured him instantly. Ayyul mali ahabbu ilayk? What form of wealth do you love? He says, well, I always loved camels, but I can only dream for it. I never owned it. فَأُعْتِيَ عَشْنَاقَةً عَشْرًا. He was given a pregnant camel. He was given a pregnant camel by this angel who came in the disguised form of a human. And then told him, بَارَكَ اللَّهُ لَكَ فِيهَا. May Allah bless you in your health also, and may Allah bless you in your wealth also. Said this and moved on, came to the man that was bald. Asked him, what do you love most? شَعْرٌ حَسَنْ. I love hair. I always say, this is the short-sightedness of man. This is the short-sightedness of man that he assumes the next man has no problem because he doesn't have my problem. So we might think, well, if a man is bald, what's so wrong about it? I'm just giving it an example. But each man in his own life knows. But literally, brothers, when I went there, you know, for a moment I was thinking, I said, I hope my own children were with me here. And I suggest to you, at times now we had the holiday vacation, many of us took our children abroad. At times, let's leave the Paris and the New York, the Dubai and Malaysia, and let us take them to these areas also. But believe me, Allah forgive, the heat itself is so intense. And that's the least concern for them. I mean, I know for myself, the heat was unbearable. The humidity was extremely high. And I'm saying, I wish my children were with me, my own children, to see how children are living in tents, literally in tents, with no water, no sanitation, absolutely nothing. Parents without children, children without parents was just but a common sight. Was just but a common sight. So he comes to the person that is bald. What do you want? I want beautiful hair. He rubs his hand, Allah gives him beautiful hair. They talk of laser treatment and this treatment. Ayyul mali ahabbu ilayk? What wealth do you like? Bakar. I love cows. I love cattle. U'tiya bakaratan hamila. He was given a pregnant cow. Barakallahu laka fiha. May Allah bless you in your health and your wealth. He comes to the blind man. What are you most passionately desirous of? أَن يَرُدَّ اللَّهُ إِلَيَّ بَصَرِي. That if the Almighty can ever restore my gaze, I will be the happiest man. فَمَسَحَهُ. Gently rubs his hand. Allah instantly restores his sight. The riwayat comes in Muslim Sharif. أَيُّ الْمَالِ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْكُ. What wealth do you love? I love sheep. He was given أُعْطِيَ نَاق أُعْطِيَ شَاتًا وَالِدًا. He was given a pregnant sheep. And then he was given dua. May Allah bless you in your health and your wealth. Nabi alayhi salam said, the angel said this and he went away. فَانْتَجَّ هَذَانِ وَوَلَّدَ هَذَا فَكَانَ لِهَذَا وَادٍ مِّنَ الْإِبِلِ وَلِهَذَا وَادٍ مِّنَ الْبَقَرِ وَلِهَذَا وَادٍ مِّنَ الْغَنَمِ. In due time, their health grew, their wealth prospered. And then the first man had a valley of camels. The second became a cattle farmer. The third had herds of sheep. Allah then sent that angel again to them. Allah sent that angel. And this is what came to me. I could visualize that angel looking at me and asking me. The voice was subtle. The implications were clear. But when I looked at the catastrophe that stares at the Muslim there, and I look at the comfort zone from which we come, I could visualize this angel telling me and talking to me. And hence I thought I share it with you. The angel came to the first person and he said, قَرِنْ قَتَعَتْ بِي الْحِبَالِ. You know what, I'm desperate. And actually my provisions are exhausted. فَلَا بَلَاغَ لِي الْيَوْمِ. I doubt I'm going to make it home. أَسْأَلُكَ بِالَّذِي أَعْطَاكَ اللَّوْنَ الْحَسَنِ وَالْجِلْدَ الْحَسَنِ بَعِيرًا أَتَبَلَّغُ بِهِ فِي سَفَرِي. Allah has given you health. Allah has given you wealth. I ask you from all these camels, if you can spare me just one. I'm very desperate. I want to mount onto it and make my way home. So this man snubs the angel, least knowing what's the outcome. He snubs the angel. Today that angel is in the form of the Indonesian children. It's in the form of the Iraqi children. It's in the form of the Palestinian widows. Yet that angel is coming. Snub not this angel, my brother, before Allah seizes what he has given you. He snubs that angel. Al-hukuku kathira. You mad, I got so many commitments. He says, I'm asking you one, my brother. No, nothing comes poor, nothing comes free. So then the angel said, okay, wait, can I talk to you? He said, talk quickly. The hadith is in Muslim. كَأَنِّي أَعْرِفُكْ. If you don't mind, I think I know you. أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَبْرَسْ. If we can just rewind into history. Were you not a man suffering leprosy? فَقِيرًا, a poor person suffering poverty and penury. أَعْطَاكَ اللَّهُ الْمَالِ. Allah then gave you health and wealth. He says, no. إِنَّمَا وُرِثْتُ الْمَالَ كَابِرًا عَنْ كَابِرٍ. I was born in the lap of comfort. I inherited a handsome legacy. Never did I see sickness and poverty. Your facts are muddled. The angel said, well, that's all I have to say. That's all I have to say. In kunta kadhiba, فَسَيَّرَكَ اللَّهُ إِلَى مَا كُنْتَ. Allah, this man is blatantly lying. Allah snatched both health and wealth from him. When that angel said it, it left that man thinking, but alas, it was too late. He came to the second person, spoke to him again, very similar remarks. I'm too occupied, I'm too engaged, I got too many commitments. Yes, go and see what is happening there. Then you will realize how we have made trivial things major issues in our lives. Trivial, petty things. Again, the angel curses the second person, comes to the third one, the blind man. He asks him, you know what, I'm desperate here. Can you spare me a sheep? Can you help me? He says, listen, my brother, قَدْ كُنْتُ أَعْمَى. I had nothing. Nay, I was blind. Allah had mercy on me and restored my gaze to me. خُذْ مَا شِئْتَ وَدَعْ مَا شِئْتَ. Do me a favor, don't take one sheep. Take as many as you want to. It was from Allah. It belongs to Allah. That angel pet him and he said, أَمْسِكْ مَالَكْ. Hold your money, I need it not. Allah sent me to test you and your companions. You will see how Allah will multiply your wealth and increase your health. And you will see how instantly Allah will seize whatever He's given your companions. Brothers, wallah, I could actually visualize that angel talking to me. When I see in the crisis, let me run you through my thoughts quickly. I left from here and I was flying direct to Singapore. From there I had a connecting flight to Medan. Unfortunately, we had a hiccup here at the airport. The flight was delayed. By the time I got to Singapore, the onward flight to Medan had already left. I was rerouted to Jakarta. I didn't have much time because I was on my way to Australia. I was rerouted to Jakarta. I spent few hours there. As a matter of fact, Jakarta was not affected by the tsunami. After spending few hours, I got on to the next leg from Jakarta to Medan. And this is where my interaction started with tsunami victims. When I boarded the flight, strangers, foreigners in the country has become a common sight for Indonesians, aid workers, relief workers. So the brother next to me greeted me and we started speaking. I told him my intentions, my whereabouts, where I'm off to, why I'm here, to link up with the Al Imdad Foundation that were working from South Africa in Bandar Aceh. So I just seen the eyes became moist. And I said, Ya Allah, I hope I haven't offended the man in any way. And then he took a deep sigh and asked him, what's the matter? It was a 2-hour flight from Jakarta to Medan. So he says, no, my daughter is married in Bandar Aceh and I have 4 grandchildren and 2 have died in the tsunami. Now, I'm not a grandparent, but there are many grandparents here. And I know for my parents how much they love my children. And there are many grandparents here. You know what you experience, what love, what passion there is. It became difficult for me to sit next to the man for the next 2 hours. What do you talk? What do you tell the man? How do you console? I got to Medan. I made Asr Namaz, hopped back onto the flight. It's a 1-hour flight to Bandar Aceh. This is the prime area. One was Bandar Aceh and one was Niyaz. Bandar Aceh is the place where most of the Muslims are staying, and this is where the greatest devastation took place. As soon as I got there, owing to the lack of time and my short stay, immediately we started moving about, going into the areas where this devastation took place. As I mentioned, our driver was a tsunami victim himself, so he had a great passion in explaining to us. Communication was a major problem, but every time he spoke, he said, tsunami, إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَالَهَا. That's all he used to say. Every time you ask him, what happened here? إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَالَهَا. When the earth will be shaken and it will throw forth its treasures. And people will say, what is wrong with this earth? We've been walking on it for decades. Never has it done this. بِأَنَّ رَبَّكَ أَوْحَى لَهَا. Today your Lord has inspired it to throw out. That's all he would say and he would drive. We move deeper and deeper till we came to the water itself. Brothers, I sat by a capsized ship, like I told you. And at that moment, this ayat flashed through my mind. What is the strength of Allah? What is the might of Allah? And this brother was telling us that after it happened, when we came to the waters were so calm. The waters were so calm and passive, as if the water was talking and saying, don't look at me, I did nothing. As if the water, these were his words, the water said, don't look at me. The water has claimed land. That which was land has now become part of the ocean for kilometers. Brothers, we've seen a ship that has been thrown 5 kilometers from the ocean. Tons. I can't tell you the weight of that. In fact, when you look at that ship, you'll never believe that it could be thrown from the shore. But then it doesn't make logic and sense for it to be anchored onto land. And beneath this here, I can't tell you how many mass graveyards we pass. On the right is a mass graveyard. Thousands of bodies lies on that side. One place they took us, a massive boat resting on the roof of a double story. The house and whatever is there, just abandoned and people have left and gone. People have pitched up little small tents at the places where their houses once upon a time existed, sitting there in small little tents and carrying on with life, facing reality as it comes. Masajid have been protected. Wallah, numerous masajid, many people perhaps had seen on the internet and photos, but we literally seen masajid that were that close to the water, where houses kilometers from the water have been sucked in, destroyed, yet the masjid just at the shore, not very far, still standing intact, still standing intact as it is. What's light, you know, minor cracks, and that we went into those masajid, we tried to interview people. As we carried on, I want to share this with you, and this was very, very emotional for me. It became the time of Maghrib. I was rather tired and exhausted owing to my long journey. But believe me, my tiredness and my fatigue, we had disappeared in seconds when I seen this reality. We came there to this masjid, and I wish I could take you in my thoughts. I can still picture that masjid. It was time of Maghrib. Around the masjid, a lot of tents pitched, so it makes it central for the people staying there. At least there's a base, they can perform their salah, and they go back to those tents. We came into the masjid. We performed Maghrib namaz. Like I told you, the heat was really at its extreme. After Maghrib namaz, the Al Imdad Foundation had a base here where they had quite a bit of the food hampers here. So we decided that we will now formally distribute the food. After Maghrib namaz was over, you know, how can I share this with you? It's like a family that has got together. It's a masjid. The men in front, there's a curtain. Behind that are the sisters. In front are the children. Children without parents, parents without children. They're all sitting. Their homes no longer exist. There are tents around the masjid. They look at you, they smile. You look at them, you want to cry. You can't talk their language, they can't talk your language. After namaz was over, they decided we will now distribute the hampers. I was given the task to give a talk. You know, many times, alhamdulillah, Allah has given me the opportunity to speak at many venues. But if I was really emotional and I was tongue twisted, was when I had thousands of orphans looking at me. And I must speak. The translator here, not very adequate in English, so I had to keep myself very simple. And I look at these children and I'm crying and I'm trying to contain myself. And I have to say words. I started off by praising Allah. And then I said, listen children, I convey to you the salams of the children of Africa. I convey to you the salams of the people of South Africa. And then all I said, there isn't much I can tell you. I have to learn from you more than you have to learn from me. But I share with you one incident of Bashir radiallahu anhu. The riwayat comes in Al-Isaba fi Tamiz is Sahaba. That this young boy came to Medina, and his mother had passed away. His father joined Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the battle. And when Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned, his father passed away. As was common among them, they all would come on the outskirts to go and receive. When Bashir radiallahu anhu came, he says, I looked for my father, I couldn't see my father. I came to Nabi alayhi salam, I said, Ya Rasulallah, madha fa'ala abi? O Nabi of Allah, where is my father? And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned his gaze. And then I realized my father was gone, and I started crying. And the Nabi of Allah pet me, and he said, Awa ma tarda ya Bashir? Ayyakuna Rasulallahi abak wa Aisha tu ummuk. Bashir, are you not happy? From today, Muhammad is your father and Aisha is your mother. I said, rest assured. Wallah, brothers, go to Indonesia. There are thousands of Bashir's line. Go to Iraq. There are hundreds of Bashir's line. Who will stand up and father these Bashir's? Who will stand up and mother these Bashir's? Mother them and you with Nabi in Jannat. Father them and you are with the prophets in Jannat. I said this. And when I said this, I just seen tears coming out of those children's eyes. I seen those elderly people crying. I cut my talk short, and thereafter we started. What an emotional. It will never leave my thoughts. Indelible. I'm standing here, someone calling out the names. The child's name is called out, the child comes forward. And then the system. I mean, we give out little sweets and our children jump and they fight and you get frustrated. A child says very calmly, very patiently. The child is called up. The person calling out would say, listen here, this child has lost both father and mother. And you see that 5-year-old child come. It was basically a box like this here that was basic provisions of three weeks, which would cost 70 South African rands. The child comes, the child smiles at you, you smile at the child. The child is so small, the child can't carry the box. You now look for a guardian. The child has no mother, no father, no senior in that family. Not one, not ten, not hundred thousands. The child comes. And for a moment I thought to myself, many a times I had the opportunity in Jalsas to call a child forward and give him a certification and then give him a prize. And he's happy. His father is watching. His mother is listening. And I said, Ya Allah, here comes this child. No mother, no father, no brother, no sister, no uncle, no aunt. You hold the child, you pet the child, you kiss the child, and you give the child very calmly. The child takes the box with the respect of guardian and goes. Allah alone knows, over 100 hampers we gave out like this year. Brothers, I cannot tell you what an emotional sight. There was one man sitting in the corner. I seized the opportunity. I went to speak to him. He said, come, I show you. He took out photos of his brothers. He took out photos of his sons and his daughters. He said, this is my one son. We were 6 in the family. All others are gone. My wife and my 3 children are gone. It's me and this one that remains. How many like this? Allah alone knows. Let me briefly tell you, the next morning, I didn't have much time. The next morning, again we went to a particular madrasa, and this is what I want to share with you. We went to this madrasa, also tsunami victims. Small children lost their parents. I'm saying small, 4, 5, 6 years old. Wallah, they sat in there, they stood up when we came, becoming hafiz. I spoke to the teacher in Arabic. These children, they recited Quran. Our children have comforts, they have luxuries. I echoed these very sentiments in Australia. I spoke to youth in many campuses, at many colleges, and many youth came back, cried and said, Wallah, we need to appreciate what Allah has given us. Really, brothers, it is way beyond comprehension to fathom the extent of the devastation. But subhanallah, there is no begging amongst them. Not one child comes begging. You know, discipline, not one child came running that give me this year, give me this year. They just sit at you and they look at you and they smile. You don't know what to say, how to talk. Over right up till Isha, we stayed there, we distributed this, we sat with people, we sat with children. It was a nice sight, and I thought of that incident of Sayyidina Umar, when that woman was stranded in the night, and then they gave food, and he said, now I want to see how she sits with joy after giving them that food. Not that they go back to a house, not that they go back to a family, they go back to a small tent. Wallah, we have lot to learn. Our children have lot to learn. We make dua to the Almighty Allah that He don't ever deprive us of the privileges He has given us. Allah give us the ability. On my return from Australia, when I got back to Singapore, I was performing namaz. An Indonesian brother came to join me in the Isha Salah. Had a chat with him. He was from Sumatra. His parents were living in Bandar Aceh. He lost his parents and 2 children. He lost his parents and his brother and his sister in Bandar Aceh. Another one-on-one experience as I boarded the flight from Bandar Aceh to Medan. Brother sitting next to me, he asked me, what you doing here? I said, no, we just came to join hands with some relief workers. He said, 140 of my own family members have passed away. Brothers, cars, you have pride over your car. Allah's qasam, cars were destroyed. Never have I seen in my life an accident destroying cars like that. What are we going to fuss about this? You see thousands of cars. You drive on your right, there are cars. Cars on your left, nobody wants to look at it. It's time we hold on to Iman. Value the ni'mat that Allah has given us. Let us dig deep into our pockets and channel our funds to those people that are needy and destitute. Allah Ta'ala give us the ability and once again make it easy for the Muslims in Indonesia and across the globe. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.